State Representative Jon Santiago is our guest this morning. So let's go on the record. As an emergency room doctor at Boston Medical Center, he is right on the front lines of the COVID-19 fight. But in his role in Beacon Hill, he's still looking for the best prescription for many issues. He's here this morning to talk about them right now. Let's go on the record.
From WCVB Channel 5, the inside word from Washington to Beacon Hill. Today's newsmakers are going on the record.
Welcome to OTR on this Super Sunday. I'm Ed Harding, along with News Center 5's political reporter Janet Wu. As the state continues its rollout of the COVID-19 vaccine, we continue to follow social distancing protocols here in Studio C. As you can see at the center desk this morning is State Rep Jon Santiago. His district includes Boston South End, which is also where Boston Medical Center is located. When he's not on Beacon Hill, you will find him in the ER at BMC. So, Dr. Rep Superman, thanks for joining us this morning.
It's great to be with you.
So, as we've pointed out, you wear so many hats, but I'm going to ask you to put on your political hat first. I don't think you're going to be surprised by this question. Are you going to run for mayor of Boston?
Well, look, Janet, there's no doubt that this mayoral election will be, I would argue, the most consequential race in Boston's history. We have a virus that has upended our society, our school, our economy, our healthcare system. And I think what I'm most worried about is what's the Boston that will come back from this. And I would argue that the next 2, 3, 4 years really need to be rooted in equity and opportunity. And I think that my skills and track record, be it in my ER physician role, state representative role, or that as a serving in the United States military, really lends itself to addressing those issues and leading Boston through that crisis. So we're taking a hard look at it. I'm in conversations with colleagues in the hospital and on Beacon Hill, and of course my family and friends. And you know, my wife has veto power here, so we'll have to talk to her about it.
So you sure sound like you are planning to run. So is the number one reason against running maybe money, for example?
No, I think I'm having very encouraging conversations with folks all across the city. And I think it's something that I'm going to have a conversation with my wife and my friends and my colleagues to decide whether this is the appropriate action to do and whether it's in my instinct. I think we have a vision to lead the city and move it forward and truly get us through this crisis. So I'm very much looking forward to engaging with people over the next coming weeks as we make a decision. So
what's your timetable, roughly? Do you think
I think the next couple of weeks you will have a decision.
So with complete respect to what you are saying, there's something right in front of the city right now. I won't assign trouble to you. You can tell me if you are, but is there trouble with the new police commissioner suddenly being put on leave? Did Mayor Walsh fail here by appointing someone without going through with the proper vetting process?
Look, as someone who works in the ER and has treated countless numbers of survivors from domestic violence, these allegations are serious, they're intolerable, and they have no place in City Hall. And so, you know, I would move forward with what Mayor Walsh decided to do, put this person on leave and make sure that there's an impartial, independent investigation.
But should he have known before he appointed him?
Well, we have to talk with the administration. I don't know what they knew or what they didn't know moving with this particular case.
So let's go to the other big subject. You've had the vaccine, but how are the immunizations going in general? Is there enough supply?
Well, I think let's take a 10,000 foot view. You know, I think we're about a year into this virus when we diagnosed the first case of coronavirus in Boston. We've had 500,000 cases. We've had almost 15,000 deaths. People are tired, people are anxious. I see this on the front lines as an ER doctor and as a representative on Beacon Hill. There are two issues for me. I think it's supply. Quite honestly, there's not enough supply across the country. We have two vaccines. You know, we had a president formerly in Trump who decided to really disregard coordinating with states. I feel optimistic about President Biden and his plan to put funds towards making sure that we can roll out the vaccine. And I think the big game changer is if we can get a third vaccine online, the Johnson & Johnson. It's one shot, and it doesn't have to be held in freezers. Now, with respect to logistics, you know, things have been rocky, to say the least, in Massachusetts. You know, we already have a fragmented, underfunded, understaffed healthcare system, and that hasn't helped. And that was there long before coronavirus has gone to our shores. Now, with the phase two rollout, you know, I'm hearing from my constituents, my patients, their concerns about this. You know, the web base that is currently being used right now, it's not operational to the fact that where I think it should be.
Is the governor responsible for this? Is the blame lie at his feet?
Well, there's no doubt that there's been a frustration amongst many of us in the legislature with respect to how the governor has rolled this out. I mean, it's a difficult job. I've put forward a piece of legislation that really looks to design a centralized scheduling intake center that really takes into account cultural competency and making sure that's linguistically appropriate. I also think that we need to make sure that these sites are really put in the communities that are hardest hit by the virus.
So rather than focus on who might be to blame for it, which is an important part of the puzzle here, the objective is to get as many shots into as many arms as can be done as rapidly and safely as possible. So how do we get there?
Well, I can assure you that these mass vaccination sites are going to play a critical role in this. This past week, I visited the Fenway, and I was surprised to see how efficient, how effective, and how safe it was. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're talking about over 90% of the doses that they received are being administrated. And so as soon as we get more of those mass vaccination sites up, whether it's Gillette, Fenway, and the Reggie Lewis Center, the better we will be
why,
for it.
Why are there hours 9 to 5, Tuesday through Saturday? Why isn't it 24/7, 365 until we get everybody vaccinated?
Well, over the course of the
supply?
The course of the incoming weeks, you're going to see an expansion of that. And I was just talking to the folks at CIC, the people manning the Fenway and Gillette station, and they're going to increase capacity in a significant way. But important, we have to make sure that equity is at the center of all this.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, go ahead. Please finish.
We have a site in the Reggie Lewis Center. Although it's placed in the heart of Roxbury, we have to make sure that folks in those neighborhoods are getting the care and the vaccinations that they deserve.
We hear a lot about all these new variants that are cropping up. How worried are you about them? And do you think that there are going to be more versions that are going to show up? And is this going to affect the vaccinations that people have already gotten?
Look, I'm very worried. You know, I think if there is a third surge in Massachusetts, it will be as a direct consequence of the variants. You know, we have three variants floating around the United States. I would argue that they're probably already here making their way through the city and the Commonwealth, and we have to do our best to get folks tested, to get folks vaccinated as soon as possible. This is really a race against this variant. How quickly we can vaccinate people will be telling in the coming weeks and months.
And some of the nation's top immunologists now say that herd immunity will take as much as a year longer than originally estimated. As a doctor, does that sound right to you? What does that sound like?
Well, it's unclear. So many variables are changing by the day. I think the initial estimates were thinking that September we would have enough herd immunity. But look, the vaccination rollout is taking longer than expected all across the country and here in Massachusetts. And we each need to do the best we can here to get folks on board, get folks vaccinated, and make sure that, again, those communities hardest hit by the virus, particularly mm-hmm. those of color, mm-hmm. Have the trust in the system to get vaccinated.
Mm-hmm. So it's basically 2021 a wash?
I would argue 2021 will largely be a wash in terms of vaccination rollout and restrictions. And again, this is why we need to really move the ball forward when it comes to vaccinating people.
Let me ask you a question about schools. You know, the CDC came right out this week and said that teachers could get back in classrooms, students could get back in classrooms. Obviously, there's some resistance and pushback on that. Is it a good idea to open up the schools, the teachers go back in, the students go back in?
I think we need to provide schools the resources and the tools so their teachers and their staff can feel safe. You know, over the past month or so, the state legislature and the governor have committed, millions of dollars to make sure we can start testing in the schools to get kids back in the school. No doubt that teachers need to be vaccinated, and I'm hoping in phase two, as soon as we get 75-year-old people vaccinated, 65 plus with 2+ comorbidities, teachers will be next in line because we need kids in schools.
Not to push back, the CDC is saying that the teachers can go in without getting vaccinated right now.
Well, I think
is that an accurate read or an inaccurate?
No, I think if you look at the studies and if you parse through the data, it would lead one to believe that schools, if people are practicing good public health practice and protocols, that schools are generally a safe place to be.
Are you saying basically that regardless of whether they've been vaccinated or not, most schools should be at least doing hybrid, if not full time?
I'd like to get kids back into school as soon as possible. I mean, in the emergency room that I'm seeing, we're seeing a number of cases with respect to mental health, particularly in pediatric children. There are risks and benefits to having kids stay at home and don't go to school. And we really need to make sure that kids are going to school as soon as possible. And I think testing, I think vaccination are the keys to doing that.